Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null, broadcasting video streaming live from our studios in New York City. Today, the latest on why a vegan diet, plant-based diet, is so good for you. Not just with heart disease and cancer, but also helping to reshape your human genome. We'll talk about that. Always from quality peer-reviewed journals, always from independent institutions doing the research that you should hear about. And we're always the cutting edge. This is the number one listened to progressive radio program in the world. So we're going to keep that in mind. So wherever you live, we're going to be sharing information that can help you. Also today, I'm going to take some calls. How many, I don't know, depending upon the question they're asking and how long it takes to give them a reasonable answer. If you'd like to call in with your question or a statement that we could all benefit from, our number, please write this down, is 862-800-6805, 862-800-6805. Also today, an in-depth, original investigative report on Wikipedia. This is number 25. But today is different. Today we're going after the person that we consider one of the main instigators of misinformation, attacking everyone in the health field that supports alternative or complementary or what is called natural healing. And this has taken us time, but we've made all the dots connected. We believe that this is the first such report ever done on Dr. Stephen Barrett and Jimmy Wales and Wikipedia and the Skeptics. This is important information. Then we're going to hear from Lee Camp. Lee Camp does a program over on HBO. He's a comedian, but he is a social satirist like none other. None of the other late-night comedians have the insight and intelligent perspective he does. We're going to have his take in a short clip on how the liberal community, represented by the corporate Democrats, they certainly don't represent all liberals, can't get over Russiagate, can't get over the idea that Trump wasn't found guilty of collusion or obstruction of justice. In any case, I think his perspective is very, very right on. Then, continuing with our ongoing series, and we have 20 such clips to show you, different ones, from some of the world's leading authorities on 5G technology, that this is one of the worst issues ever to be brought forward without open and honest discussion that could impact every single person on the planet. Because once they start implementing this, and they are, you already see the ads, but they're making it seem very nice. Oh, you're going to be able to get a movie downloaded quicker or make a phone call easier. What they're not telling you is the 28,000 studies, we found them, 28,000 studies in the peer-reviewed literature on what is this G5 technology and how many dangerous consequences there are to it. I'll also be sharing something during that with you because I'm going to ask our engineer, as he's playing this, I'm going to stop and give you commentary of what he's saying because he's a professor. He's one of the world's leading authorities on the subject, but he can also be a little too scientific for the lay person. So I'm going to be playing a piece, then discussing it, what it means in lay language. And you also hear about how Bill Clinton, back in 1996, passed a Communications Act. Now get this, that prevents the public, the EPA, the National Academy of Sciences, the FDA, or any other health agency from interfering in where they place these towers. So Bill Clinton and Hillary Clinton, they were co-presidents, actually put the interest of the telecom industry ahead of health consequences to this technology. Boy, is that coming back to vitus because these companies are now saying it doesn't matter the health consequences. There are no studies. Yeah, there are. You just haven't done any because when you did, you sold the negative outcome. We have the studies. So 5G is the single most dangerous thing happening in the world today. It is more dangerous than genetically modified food. It is more dangerous than glyphosate because no one can opt out of it, as you will see. So we're going to do 20 segments, more than any other media in the world, and serious people. So that's our show. Let's begin. When I first came to New York City and I began to talk about health, there was one concept that was going around. It was called, you are what you eat. And therefore, why eat anything that's junky or diseased or denatured? Why not eat vital? And hence the whole philosophy of vitalism that is not new. It goes clear back to the ancient Greeks and comes right up forward through Maimonides, Socrates, and Montaigne, Voltaire, even Thoreau, that have things that are vitally interesting and vitally important in your life. So it's more than just what you eat, and it's the quality of your thoughts, because that's the food for the consciousness, your thoughts. So now Cornell University did a study, and it shows the evidence of a vegetarian diet permanently shaping the human genome to change individual risks for cancer and heart disease. Now, what does this mean to you? In a new evolutionary proof of the old adage that we are what we eat, according to Cornell University scientists, they have found evidence that a vegetarian diet has led to a mutation that if they stray from a balanced omega 3 to 6 fatty acids may make people more susceptible to inflammation and by association increase risk of heart disease and colon cancer. So what does this science show? The science has been there for decades showing that the more meat, dairy, alcohol, refined carbohydrates that you eat, the greater risk of your colon cancer occurring or heart disease occurring, because these actually change your genome. Whereas if you are on a healthy plant-based diet, let's say the Mediterranean diet, that is more or less a plant-based diet, then you have less opportunity for these diseases. The discovery was led by a group of scientists and provide evolutionary detective work that traces of a higher frequency of a, you know, the fatty acids go in the diet of a vegetarian diet can make a difference. So, eat a healthy diet, help prevent breast cancer, prostate cancer, colorectal cancer, heart disease. And this was published in the Journal of Molecular Biology and Evolution. When I was on one of my trips to Italy, I wanted to go into the Italian Alps, the mountains. It's not far from Milano. It's not far from Rome. And a couple hours. But up in this ridge of mountains, you'll see people anywhere from 3,000 to 6,000 feet elevation living in small villages. I was there at one time. I was there in the summer. And there were a group of my friends. My brothers came with me and two of my friends who are Italian. And so they were the ones doing the translation. And it was a hot day and I was training for the marathon. So I was running in front of a Jeep and we would run from little hamlet to hamlet. And there might be anywhere from 4 to 12 homes, more or less, a couple miles apart. And everyone knew everyone. And some of these people had lived in these homes for hundreds of years. We met a family that lived in the same house, the whole lineage, for 800 years. Beautiful woodwork done there. And these people were vitally healthy. In fact, I spent the whole afternoon there, and I saw how they used land that no one in America would farm. It was just almost straight up and straight down. And these people had huge thighs. Now, I was bodybuilding and powerlifting for years, and I had large thighs. My thighs paled compared to one of the 80 and 9-year-old guys. He had been doing this every day, up and down. They'd have this sack that they'd have over, like a pouch they'd put over their shoulder. And as he's going up this hill, he'd be picking beans or another row of tomatoes or another row of peppers and stick them in there. And then a young kid would come up, hand him the bag, get a new bag, take that old bag down. It's what they did all day long. So their musculatures were phenomenally strong. They had very little fat. And they weren't all into health. I mean, they smoked, and that wasn't good. But boy, did they take their time eating. And they took their time enjoying each other. And I just remember sitting at the end of a dining table watching them as their eyes just sparkled with delight and joy and love for each other. It gave me this very warm feeling because growing up, where I grew up, and I'm sure where you grew up, most of you, you were expected to all be at home for dinner and whatever issues you had to discuss. That's where you discussed them. And there was a sense of manners. And most importantly, there's a sense of character. I don't care what community in America you went to. If you were in a block community in the South Bronx, or you were living down in a small Texas town, character was important. Now, why was character important? Because character was who you were. And your reputation, your personality, was what you wanted other people to believe you were. But at the end of the day, whether you kept your word, whether you were loyal, whether you were trustworthy, whether you were ethical and moral, polite, decent, these represented the sum total of your character. And your mother was instrumental in making sure in that home that those were virtues that you appreciated. I saw this in every single community I went, whether it was in Spain or France or in Italy, Ireland, Scotland, England, doesn't matter, Jamaica. The importance of family, the importance of valuing things that are important to everyone. So here's this village, and I saw that the people were older but did not fear death. I asked him about that. I asked a couple, one was 93 and one was 91, what do you think about when you wake up in the morning as you approach senescence or end of life? And the man just laughed and he said, if we're not afraid of living, why would we be afraid of dying? It's just a natural process. We're going to be as happy as we can be until that moment occurs. And then the best that we have been in our lives will be what others remember us by. And a younger person, a son of this man, said, would you rather be remembered for your wealth and possessions or the joy that you brought people, the laughter, the warm-heartedness? And I said, of course, that's what I'd like to be remembered by. He says, well, that's what we live by here, this whole region. I don't care what community you go to here. We know everyone because when you've been here for hundreds of years, you have to cooperate. So there's always cooperation. Now think of how little cooperation we have on people living on the same floor in the same building for 20 years. You know, you'll say hello and that's it, if that. And boy, was that an important lesson. So yesterday, when I'm in the park and going for a run, just as I was entering the park, suddenly flashed in my mind when it was a British television news program, it was either Channel 4 or the BBC, 30 years ago, when running was really taking off in New York, and we had the second largest running and walking club in New York. We had almost 800 members, and which is still meeting. We met yesterday. We'll meet this coming Sunday at 8 o'clock at 5th Avenue and 90th Street. And because of where I was running into the park, it's where we did the filming, and all these memories flash back of all the people who've come and gone through the running and walking club, who did marathons that they would never have done, how that changed them, how the training for marathon gave them the strength and discipline to challenge anything else in life, because no matter how you feel at the 20th mile, when you finish the marathon and they put that medal around your neck and every person finished gets a medal, you realize, now I'm not limited because of what it took to do that. Anyhow, I just at that moment, I ran into Stella Cashman, who said that she just dissolved that walking club that so many of us were privileged to walk in. And she was Helene Britton and Howard Jacobson and Stella Cashman were the three people who were most responsible for supporting the power walking, race walking community in New York for the last 40 years. Without them, there would have been none. Now there is none. It's over. And I stood there and I talked with Stella, and something popped into my mind. I said, Stella, some of the finest racers in America raced here. And there was patience, there was kindness given, there was support by all the clubs in the racing community. We worked together. And she said, yes. And she said, but that day's come and gone. Think of it this way. I just want to plant the seed in your mind today. If you're a man and you're over 38, you're on the downside of your life cycle. If you're a woman and you're 40, you're on the downside of your life cycle, meaning you're now going from a vibrancy of growth into the decline towards death. That's a hard concept to wrap your mind around. So if you know now after 36, if you're a man, and 40 if you're a woman, you're dying, what then do you want to change? What do you believe is more important now in this segment of your life than in the last segment? What is vital? What responsibilities would you like to have, and what responsibilities should you no longer have? How will you change your priorities? Or are you just going to be on remote and just go through formalized, conditioned rituals each day until you're dead? And that's one of the reasons I believe we're a nation suffering from an epidemic of depression, anxiety, and sadness and loneliness. Whereas I do not see that in any of the communities I traveled through throughout the world. But it's absolutely common here in the United States. Just something that I believe that we should all have something to focus our energy on that allows us to honor the best that we have been taught, the best we could be, and the best that we should be in the future. So there's still something to do. Think about that. So anyhow, in this remote Italian village, they said at the University of California, San Diego, that they have found people who've really got the key to longevity. Now, the average life expectancy in the United States is approximately 78 years of age. Now, you could live longer with better diets and improved health care, but most people are not. In fact, get this. The latest statistic is how many Americans reach 100? 0.02% will hit the century mark. Now, to understand how people can live longer throughout the world, researchers from the University of California at San Diego School of Medicine have teamed up with colleagues at the University of Rome to study a group of 300 citizens, all over 100, living in a remote Italian village nestled between the ocean and mountains on the country's coast. And they were the first to go in there, but I believe that that was one of the areas that we were in because it had a reputation. Everybody kept talking about it. But we went to so many places. I didn't ask them the name of these places. And they found that these people have a very healthy diet. They have very little cardiovascular disease or cancer. They almost have no diverticular diseases, no spastic colon. None of the diseases you see commercials that, oh, you got to run off to a bathroom every 5 minutes because of some form of spastic colon condition. No. If you eat high fiber, that cleans up the intestine. If you're taking fermented foods, that gives you probiotics. If you're eating lower caloric value, the telomeres, the end caps of your chromosomes, are going to last longer. If you're happy and laugh, and laughter, just 1 minute of real laughter each day can add a lot of time onto your lifespan because it stimulates your immune system in a positive way. So when you're around people you love, you're around your family and friends, you have a meaning to your life. You take nothing for granted. You respect everything. All those are the lessons from people, and yet with all of our science and $3.5 trillion spent on our medical bill, we've learned none of that. None of it at all. Just something to think about. And finally, the Mediterranean diet can help lower your hip fracture if you're an older woman. This University of Würzburg in Germany. So eating a Mediterranean diet can at least lower an older woman's risk of hip fracture. That's a new study. And that's mainly the high fruits, high vegetables, nuts, legumes, whole grains. You had a 20% lower risk of hip fracture compared to women who didn't follow the regimen. So that is good hope for a lot of people. Oh, and by the way, I got to ask a question yesterday. Someone in the park says they heard that maple syrup is good, but they thought it was bad. No, organic maple syrup can actually help reduce chronic inflammation. And they can read about this in the University of Rhode Island did a study, the first ever global symposium dedicated to sharing the latest scientific benefits, and says that if it's 100% pure maple products, then yes, it is anti-inflammatory. And that's why you can put pure maple syrup over your hot cereal in the morning, and it's really good for you. And by the way, the peanut protein, which most people don't eat, has bioactive nutrients to keep your arteries open. New study from Pennsylvania State University on that, published in the Journal of Nutrition. And high doses of vitamin C improve cancer treatment, and that passes a human safety trial. And that was the University of Iowa. So clinical trials found that it is safe to regularly infuse brain and lung cancer patients with 1,000 times the daily recommended amount of vitamin C as a strategy. Well, let me just see for a moment. And they're saying that's the first? No. For 12 years, on over 4,000 patients, the medical team, medical board certified physicians and nurses using my protocols of up to 200,000 milligrams of vitamin C. We had physicians coming in, not Linus Pauling came in. And based upon my research on quercetin that I was giving that was destroying the HIV virus, he began to use quercetin, and a Dr. Jirwala, 2 years later, was killing the HIV virus in culture at the Linus Pauling Institute. Then a Dr. Cathcart, Robert Cathcart, came in. He said, I heard from people that you're doing good work with AIDS-defining illnesses. And I said, well, see for yourself. I've asked the patients, will they consent to share their medical records with inquiring physicians and journalists? They said yes. And so talk with the patients. And he did. He was there for a week, every day, all day. And we were open from 8 in the morning till midnight, 7 days a week. And he was so convinced by what he saw and the people he interviewed that he went back and started using 50,000 milligrams a day on patients with Kaposi sarcoma, pneumocystis, pneumonia. And he wrote me a year later and said, I have not had a single patient die, and I'm able to help them overcome these conditions. So, University, you're a little late. You're 35 years late, but that's all right. At least it's out there now. I'm Gary Null, and that's the latest on health and healing. We're going to take a quick break, and I want to come back and do our in-depth original investigative report. Please stay with us. Welcome, all of you. I'm in our studio in New York City, video streaming this. You can go to Gary Null Facebook and watch it or download it later. And I want to thank the 36,000 people for their downloads. We have a lot of people listening all over the world, and a lot of them can't listen. And just over the weekend, we have people download shows. So if you want to listen to a program on the archives, because you can't listen in live time, here's the number that you will call. The archive is 701-719-9976. Again, 701-719-9976. Tomorrow evening on the Progressive Commentary Hour, I'm going to present for the first time, I've never done this before, a short documentary. It's 30 minutes long. It's a very positive, uplifting, feel-good documentary. So I'm going to say, tune in tomorrow, 7 p.m., for the Progressive Commentary Hour. The first half will be the documentary. The second half will be guests, 4 to 6 guests from the documentary. But it's a very powerful, positive documentary you won't want to miss tomorrow night. The following will be posted immediately on our main page at prn.fm. The article is entitled Wikipedia, Cesspool of Slander and Misinformation. During the past year, we have released 24 separate investigative stories about Wikipedia, its co-founder, Jimmy Wales, and the fringe movement of skeptics who have gained monopolistic editorial control over Wikipedia entries dealing with natural health and nutrition and complementary and alternative healing modalities, such as chiropractic, acupuncture, homeopathy, what is called holistic or alternative medicine, traditional Chinese medicine, naturopathy, and body-mind medicine as well. Yet we are unaware of any journalist in the mainstream media or persons within the larger medical and scientific communities who has asked a basic question. Are Wikipedia editors accurate? How much knowledge and expertise do they possess in the subjects they are critiquing? We have. And we are appalled by our discoveries. Besides using its leverage as the single most visited website influencing people's information and decisions on health matters, there seems to be growing evidence that Wikipedia is in violation of its IRS status. And tomorrow we are posting a letter to the Inspector General of the Internal Revenue Service with details of our 2-year investigation, showing you multiple occasions where we believe, and our attorneys believe, and our researchers and scholars believe, that Wikipedia should no longer have a nonprofit status. You'll have an opportunity to read it and also join in on that. Jimmy Wales and his skeptic comrades have covertly inculcated the encyclopedia with medical ideologies while relying upon slander to stage an offensive that would destroy the reputations of health disciplines, both of the people practicing the discipline itself, and the patients, because they disagree with them. Now I'm going to provide one glaring example of an individual who has been the most highly referenced resource for the skeptic aggression, Dr. Stephen Barrett. Barrett has been the progenitor of attacks on many natural health disciplines for over 40 years. His vehemence towards chiropractic is well known. The organizations he co-founded and directed for decades have been a source of unscientific bias against alternative and complementary health practitioners such as Dr. Preeti Breggin, myself, Dr. Memet Oz, Dr. Andrew Weil, and dozens of others. Barrett's unsubstantiated claims form the basis of my Wikipedia biography. Now, you might think that after repeated efforts to correct the site's misinformation and the lack of any credible citations, Wikipedia editors would honor the encyclopedia's mandatory editorial standards. You would be wrong. That is not the case. Therefore, we are providing a background on Dr. Barrett and his allies in private industry, whom he has served to discredit alternative medicine and medical experts who raise concerns, legitimate concerns, concerns we should all have, over the health risks of corporate products and chemicals, such as processed sugar, tobacco, fluoride, pesticides, food preservatives, mercury in fillings, and other things that you and I would never use. If we're able to locate this information, why couldn't Wikipedia editors and Jimmy Wales? Why couldn't the mainstream media that is cited Stephen Barrett is an expert? many people have been wrongfully injured by Wikipedia editors, including Sharyl Attkisson, Deepak Chopra, Rupert Sheldrake, and we consistently find the same individuals of this medicine by McCarthyism within Weil's inner circle of skeptics acting as the protectors of the medical industrial complex and as the interrogators against natural health. This is a modern day witch hunt. This is the modern day version of the Inquisition. It is certainly modern day McCarthyism. The consequence is that truth is frequently selectively absent and Wikipedia users are unjustifiably being misled. The height of scientific vanity is found amongst those who engage in endless futile endeavors to contort science in order to prove their rightness and morality. These are the so-called skeptics who refuse to look plainly at those things that challenge their fundamental understanding about the subjects they hold dear. For this reason, skeptics are often accused and ridiculed for espousing scientific materialism, reductionism, and for promulgating an extremely limited view of human biology, the mind, consciousness, and the practice of medicine. In our opinion, modern conventional medicine has built a citadel, a walled fortress that refuses to take centuries of medical wisdom and practices seriously. And skeptics are up to their necks in the culture of denial, imprisoned within these ramparts, constructed with the mortar of pharmaceutical drugs, chemotherapy, radiation, and unsafe vaccines, GMOs, and a legacy of medical error, illness, and death. For the past 100 years, non-conventional medicine, meaning chiropractic, naturopathy, homeopathy, nutritional therapy, herbs, holistic medicine, has been up against a formidable list of enemies. Now, this goes back to the Carnegie Rockefeller-sponsored Flexner Report in 1910, which established the perimeters by which modern conventional medicine, as we know it, has grown and developed. Parallel to the reports establishing a drug-based curriculum for medical education while censoring all natural healing modalities. The American Medical Association became the nation's central medical authority. The AMA is arguably the nation's single non-government entity that has taken all of the power of medical selection to itself. In our opinion, since the start of the 20th century, the AMA has had a single agenda: manipulate and brainwash the public to only place its trust in conventional licensed medical physicians. According to Joseph Lisa, author of The Assault on Medical Freedom, who gained access, as I did, to the AMA's Department of Investigation files, they were left with my doorman. I published these. I did two articles on them, on the corruption of the AMA, and they were found guilty. And their guilt was upheld at the Supreme Court in violation of restraint of trade. They were trying to destroy the entire field of chiropractic. They failed. We won. And that's the only reason chiropractic survived, because it was on the ropes. It was considered an unscientific cult until Joe Lisa's report and my articles, and then the lawsuits against the AMA and 12 other, the major, largest medical organizations in America. They were all sued. They all lost. One settled. But that didn't stop them for 25 years from carrying on this secret, clandestine campaign to destroy all alternative therapies. They were doing it out of the basement of the AMA headquarters. The AMA actively sought the creation of what Lisa said was, quote, totalitarian medical pharmaceutical police state. The association has spawned other organizations and covert operations with mandates to stamp out any and all natural therapies. Anything that competes with big pharma or the hospitals or doctors is to be destroyed. However, the two most menacing pro-medical industrial organizations to penetrate their tentacles into the wider public network of professional medical organizations and societies pro-industry advocacy groups, almost all the mainstream media outlets, and especially Wikipedia, have been those founded by former psychiatrist and radical skeptic Dr. Stephen Barrett. The National Council Against Health Fraud and Quackwatch Inc. The National Council Against Health Fraud is an offshoot of the AMA's original group and a group that was called the CCHI, and that stood for Coordinating Conference on Health Information. That was a covert operation that grew out of the AMA's now-defunct Committee on Quackery. Both the CCHI and the National Council Against Health Fraud have been consecrated by federal health agencies and the pharmaceutical industrial complex, yet neither operate with any institutional oversight or scrutiny, government or otherwise, and both serve the AMA's larger mission. Barrett and his supporters unanimously deny that he and the NCHF and Barrett's later organization, Quackwatch, have any association with the federal health agencies and private interest. However, the National Council Against Health Fraud's umbrella organization, the CCHI, had a far larger enterprise that included relationships with the Federal Trade Commission, the Food and Drug Administration, the U.S. Postal Service, the American Pharmaceutical Association, the Internal Revenue Service, the Attorney General's Office, the U.S. Office of Consumer Affairs, and the Better Business Bureau. Operating under the disguise of, quote, consumer protection, end quote, Barrett's Quackwatch assumed the task of information gathering about the practices and use of chiropractic, acupuncture, homeopathy, naturopathy, vitamin therapies, non-conventional medical modalities, and books on alternative health, and then report back to his group. A Canadian lawsuit against Barrett ruled that, quote, the sole purpose of the activities of Barrett and Barrett's, one of his associates, are to discredit and cause damage and harm to the healthcare practitioners, businesses that make alternative health therapies or products available, and advocates of non-allopathic therapies and health freedom, end quote. Let me repeat just part of that and show you why that's important. Because what's said in a court of law under oath, what's said in depositions, can be used because it's a matter of legal reference. So Wikipedia should never, in my opinion, have allowed Stephen Barrett to write anything about me or anyone else, since it's shown that he already had a strong bias. Had they done their homework, any journalist using him as a source should have looked to see his own background. And when it says, quote, the sole purpose of the activities of Barrett and Barrett's are to discredit and cause damage and harm to healthcare practitioners, businesses that make alternative health therapies or products available, and advocates of non-allopathic therapy. So if you oppose vaccination, if you oppose GMOs, if you oppose sugar in the diet, if you oppose mercury in the food, if you oppose the overdrugging or medication, well, the likelihood is that Barrett or someone affiliated with him would be challenging you. Has Barrett received funding from private interests? During one court proceeding, during examination, Barrett conceded his ties to the AMA, the Federal Trade Commission, and the FDA. Barrett's membership on the American Council on Science and Health, this is very important. Please listen to what I'm going to tell you, because I can assure you, you're not going to know what this is. There's an organization called the American Council on Science and Health. And he, Barrett, sits on their board of scientific advisors. And that indicates that he has served as a spokesperson for private corporations for a very long time, for over 40 years. Similar to Quackwatch, the American Council on Science and Health calls itself a consumer advocacy organization and claims to support evidence-based science. I remember when I debated its founder and on national radio, on the Bob Kane Show on NBC. It was on sugar. She said that sugar was not a problem. I said it was. She had no science. I had 12 major studies from peer-reviewed literature on sugar and heart disease and cancer, etc. Afterwards, after the show, when we were in the hall, I said, if you're not aware of these studies, this is just a sampling I brought. I have many more. You could take these. And she just turned around and walked into the elevator. I don't think she wanted anything more to do with me. But that's when I was debating everyone I could from every industry, the Cattlemen's Association, the dairy industry, the pharmaceutical industry. I debated everyone until they wouldn't debate anymore because we had science-based evidence. They had opinion. And that was the difference. So what do you do when someone can win a debate by having evidence? You simply don't invite them to debate. And you invite someone who's pro-industry in its place. Someone you know is not going to rock the boat. Nevertheless, its platforms are radically pro-industry and advocate for genetically modified foods, industrial agriculture, nuclear power, vaccine mandates, natural gas and hydrofracking, and the degradation or deregulation of toxic chemicals. Practically every trustee member that we looked up and looked into their background has direct ties to large corporations. Journalist Gary Ruskin has identified the ACSH as a front group for, quote, the tobacco, chemical, fossil fuel, cosmetic, and pharmaceutical industries, end quote. It has defended Monsanto against lawsuits charging glyphosate or Roundup as being carcinogenic. But hold on. Didn't the second lawsuit just get resolved last week where they had to pay, what, $71 million? And they've got 14,000 more lawsuits, and that'll probably triple behind them. Well, Bayer, who bought Monsanto, is going to go out of business, in my opinion. Its stock has already dropped over half, I believe. So mind you, when you're defending glyphosate, and you're defending Monsanto, and you're defending the tobacco industry, then look at the record over a period of time. Court records reveal that Monsanto funneled money to that same organization. And the French leading publication Le Monde investigation found the organization lobbying on behalf of Big Agra. Mother Jones' report uncovered that in 2012, that same organization's donors included, ready? These are just some of the people that gave money to this organization. Chevron, Coca-Cola, Bristol-Myers Squibb, also Bayer, Crop Science, Procter & Gamble, Syngenta, 3M, McDonald's, and tobacco giants like Altria and Philip Morris. The organization initiated efforts to receive funding for lobbying services rendered for Pepsi-Cola, Monsanto, British American Tobacco, Dow Agro, ExxonMobil Foundation, and Reynolds America. It also cemented close ties with the Koch family, the owners of Koch Industries, and the major funders of the Randian Pro-Industry American Legislative Exchange Council, or ALEX. This includes receiving funds from David Koch Foundation, the Koch family-controlled Claude R. Lambie Foundation, and Koch Industries Allied Public Relations from the Bradley Foundation. Tom Golab, a trustee of the American Council on Science and Health, was an executive at the Media Research Center, an ultra-conservative media group funded by large right-wing foundations and front organizations who provided, quote, intellectual ammunition, end quote, to conservative efforts such as ALEC. On practically all matters concerning health, we believe the American Council on Science and Health relies upon junk corporate science. A significant amount of its energy is spent fighting against regulations and restrictions for products with highly toxic chemicals or are known to have severe health risks. Speaking about the organization's co-founder, Elizabeth Whalen, an FDA information director said, quote, her organization is a sham, an industry front, end quote. Its former executive director, Dr. Gilbert Ross, spent 23 months in prison for defrauding New York State Medicaid program out of $8 million. The judge ruled Frost was, quote, a highly untrustworthy individual, end quote. He was released from prison just a year before being selected to lead the American Council on Science and Health and held the post for almost 15 years. Even before its FDA approval, Ross was promoting Merck's Gardasil vaccine with claims it would be, quote, among the greatest medical discoveries of modern times, end quote. Whalen herself, the one I debated, had been caught hiding her organization's tie to private corporations. In effect, Whalen created an industry of writing scientific information pamphlets to advertise junk science that protects industry interest and their unhealthy products. If a toxic product has received bad press, the American Council on Science and Health will be an ally to clean up its image. The watchdog group, Center for Science and the Public Interest, and originally a Ralph Nader group, and Howard Jacobson was the head of it for decades. Very nice man. I knew him. And they also issued a report on the American Council on Science and Health strategies and methods to promote fraudulent science for whitewashing some of the most dangerous products threatening public health. The report states, quote, "The American Council on Science and Health appears to be a consumer fraud. As a scientific group, they seem to arrive at conclusions before conducting studies. Through voodoo or alchemy, bodies of scientific knowledge are transmogrified into industry-oriented positive statements," end quote. Among its more dangerous and life-threatening positions are, listen carefully, secondhand smoke is not harmful, humans are not responsible for global warming, hydrofracking is clean and does not pollute water resources, all pesticides approved in the United States are safe and have never been associated with any illness, GMOs pose no human health or environmental threats, chemicals used in flame retardants pose no health risks, scientifically proven endocrine destroyers such as the phthalates and biphenyl A are safe, end quote. And defending the nutritional value of fast food also. And during the early years of the AIDS epidemic, the American Council on Science and Health was, quote, stridently anti-homosexual, portraying gay people as agents of human destruction, end quote. In our opinion, if there is any commercial product that has been shown to endanger human health and the environment, you can be certain that the American Council on Science and Health supports it. There has been growing controversy over scandals of public relations firms ghostwriting scientific articles under the disguise of independence on behalf of pharmaceutical and agricultural companies. Of course, these are service-for-fee relationships, and the American Council on Science and Health has been found engaging in this practice. In 2009, the American Council on Science and Health personally sent out a request for $100,000 to pesticide maker Syngenta in exchange for producing a, quote, consumer-friendly booklet, end quote, promoting the safety of its pesticide, aldrazine. Aldrazine has been categorized as an endocrine-disrupting agent associated with demasculinization of amphetamines. It has been listed as a possible carcinogen in the President's Cancer Panel report and has been tied to miscarriages, reduced male fertility, and birth defects. It's important to unveil the cesspool at the American Council on Science and Health for what it really is, because Barrett's relationship as an inside advisor with the American Council on Science and Health is very disturbing and should raise alarms. In our opinion, it completely discredits him from being a reliable and unbiased scientific resource on any matter. And in our opinion, it should convince any sane person that Barrett has no integrity whatsoever in being a voice capable of speaking for the best interest of the average consumer. And the entire skeptic movement, Jimmy Wells especially, and his editorial trolls on Wikipedia, and all of those who bow before James Randi and pay dues to the Center for Inquiry, are complicit in propping up a draconian medical regime to silence real scientific inquiry and exploration. Barrett continues to serve as a scientific advisor on the American Council on Science and Health, which he joined in 1978. He was the editor of Elizabeth Whelan and Fred Astaire's 1975 book Panic in the Pantry, which accused all those who practice alternative medicine or quacks as having, quote, credentials not recognized by responsible scientists and educators, end quote. In our opinion, it is clear that Barrett has always been shilling for corporate interest. His intimate affiliation with the American Council on Science and Health and its leaders became an extension of his quack watch propaganda reach, and he has used it very effectively. In fact, Nicholas Martin worked as an editor for the group. And later, he was asked to write an article for Nutrition Forum, a publication Barrett edited. Martin undertook the request to test Barrett's integrity. He writes on his blog, quote, "The reason I let Barrett publish his report under my name is that he made no effort to authenticate any of the information I supplied to him. He simply took the word of someone who had never met, he had never met me, and whose assertions validated his own assumptions, and he then submitted his writing as a someone else's work to prominent scientific publisher and his readers. It is even among exhibits submitted in a 1994 congressional subcommittee that conducted a hearing on dietary supplements, and I so learned firsthand how quack-busting works," end quote. In our opinion, for Barrett to make any claim of independence from industry interest is utterly laughable. Quackwatch's tactics are taken directly out of the American Council on Science and Health playbook. Like his friend, the late Elizabeth Whalen, Barrett has mastered the art of working in the shadows to conceal his private supporters. For many years, it was a mystery how Barrett and his Quackwatch colleagues were capable of filing numerous lawsuits against chiropractors and alternative health practitioners with legal expenses in the hundreds of thousands of dollars, when at the same time, Barrett reported in one court trial that his earnings were, quote, $60,000. This is even more inexplicable when we consider that out of 40 cases filed, all of which were lost in court, he was still responsible for picking up the tab on legal fees. Such cases can run in hundreds of thousands of dollars each, similar to his other friend, Gilbert Ross. Barrett has had his own problems with charges against him. In 2003, a California appeals court found Barrett and his colleagues, Dr. Wallace Sampson, quote, listen carefully, this is the court, California appeals court, quote, Barrett, to be biased and unworthy of credibility. Let me repeat that for Wikipedia. To allow a person who is called, quote, to be biased and unworthy of credibility, quote, to be biased and unworthy of credibility, and you're allowing that person to edit mine or anyone else's information and then not change it when it was brought to your attention, that is malice aforethought. That means the intent to do harm. And you'll all see very shortly the consequences of that. This was after Barrett's organization, the National Council Against Health Fraud, sued 43 different alternative practitioners for practicing, quote, scientifically unproven method medicine. Some of these were large cases. Some had follow-up appeals as well. So who was funding Barrett's lawsuits for all these many years? References to Stephen Barrett and Quackwatch riddle Wikipedia's pages on practically every alternative medical and healing tradition and discipline, as well as the personal biographies of alternative medicine's leading practitioners and advocates. And in conclusion, one of Barrett's big fans is Wikipedia's co-founder, Jimmy Wales. Both share a lot in common as supporters of the skeptic movement to advance scientific atheism and create pharmaceutical regimes that stay in power. Barrett has been the co-chair of the Health Claims Subcommittee at the Committee for Skeptical Inquiry, one of Skeptics' flagship organizations since 1980. It's a curiosity how Barrett, who holds no degrees in nutrition or dietetic science, could be consistently regarded and quoted as an expert pundit about nutrition by mainstream media. His credentials are solely self-professed and have been fabricated to maintain his marketability for the institutions that back him, nor has he ever shown a deep knowledge of the therapies he attacks. For example, when questioned in an interview about his knowledge of therapies he chastises, such as acupuncture, homeopathy, and chiropractic, he stated that they are simply too illogical to be effective and they, quote, don't need to be tested because they simply don't make any sense, end quote. This accurately defines Barrett's criteria for, quote, scientific method that he has using for his entire career as the skeptic grand inquisitor against natural health physicians and practitioners. Nevertheless, he has appeared countless times across the major networks comment on medical controversies or to promote pharmaceutical interest over claims of safer natural remedies. Barrett calls himself a legal expert, end quote, but has no professional legal training. He continues to identify himself as a psychiatrist, although he failed his medical board certification back in the 1990s or earlier and has not legally practiced for several decades. And as a trained psychiatrist, we're not aware of any formal scientific background qualifying him to speak either for or against chiropractic, nutrition, and supplements, herbal medicine, homeopathy, traditional Chinese medicine, or holistic and natural therapies. Although there are tens of thousands of studies in the peer-reviewed literature, clinical trials, that show that these work. So, there's where we're at. Barrett has never displayed any sound knowledge of the scientific literature. Instead, in the tradition of all of the devoted modern skeptics, it seems that Barrett regards himself as a holy crusader in the medical wars between good and evil. The sanctified medical establishment, ruled over by the cathedrals of the AMA, the federal health agencies, which are fully captured by pharmaceutical interest, against the heretical cults of natural health, who prefer to treat illnesses as safely and cheaply as possible. Barrett is part of a long lineage of failed healers. His earlier predecessor, who embodied overzealous savagery against alternative health care, notably chiropractic, was the AMA's top editor-in-chief, Morris Fishbein, and we are doing an article just on Fishbein, and you will not believe what we've uncovered. So there you have it. Fishbein failed anatomy in medical school and never completed his internship. Barrett may well be the entire medical establishment's greatest absurdity. In our opinion, he is a burlesque character representing the buffoonery of the skeptic movement and a large segment of the Wikipedia editorial process. U.S. court system's ruling that Barrett is, quote, biased and unworthy of credibility is enough evidence for removing all references to Barrett and his quackbusters as legitimate sources of scientifically reliable information. His perceptions and opinions about doctors and healers practicing non-conventional medicine are as equally skewed, distorted, and capricious as the legal system would have us believe. Yet Fishbein and the American Council on Science and Health and Barrett and the Quackbusters have set up what is nothing less than a medical inquiry. And they are in power because no one has done their homework. Isn't it time that the media did its job for once and looked deeply into someone's background? But that will not happen. Our assessment of the evidence indicates that Wikipedia is a fraud and should not be supported, and a dangerous one at that. And yet it has been hiding in plain sight. It's time for a congressional investigation to permit those who have been slandered to testify and force Wells and his editors to speak up under oath to the IRS Inspector General. A review of Wikipedia's behavior and activities could result in the loss of the Wikipedia nonprofit status. Further articles will be forthcoming. That I promise you. I'm Gary Null. Thank you all for listening and have a nice day.